Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
On this dreary, rainy day, but I'm not complaining. Craig D. Lausenberg said, packaged inside of every mistake, there are layers of great lesson. And while I don't want to take the mistake into the new year, I most certainly want to take the lesson that's packaged inside of it. William E. Vaughan, an optimist stays up until midnight to see the new year in. A pessimist stays up to make sure it goes out. Joan Rivers, I'm sure most of us remember Joan Rivers. Listen, I wish I could tell you it gets better, but it doesn't get better. You get better. And rules to a better 2022. Number one, pray always. Never hate. Don't worry. Live simply. Expect a little. Give a lot. Always smile. Live with love. Meditate on God's word. And best of all, be with God. Chris?
Your house, your home, we welcome you today. This is your house, your home, we welcome you today. This is your house, your home.
It's almost a little bold of us to welcome God in his house. But it's also beautiful when it matters, when it's from the heart, that you feel that way. Let's open in prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Trust this year. It's beautiful to see this past year leave. I was thinking about it and talking with Louise about it, and I was saying, this was a tough year. Really tough year. I'm glad to see it go. And then I thought to myself, wait a minute. I went through a lot this year. I never went through it alone. It was a good year. No one said it was going to be a cakewalk. But if you know that when you're going through these tough times, you're not going through them alone, that God is with you every step of the way, it's a good year. And let's face it, there's no such thing as a perfect year. That'll be when we get to heaven. We've seen enough in this past year to know how tough things can get. We're not used to it. We're used to happy days, the 50s. Father knows best the wonderful years that they are. But times are changing. But as long as we change with the times, knowing that God is walking with us, changing with us, it's a blessing. I'm going to be doing a lot of scripture reading today because there's no better way to bring in the new year than on God's word, not my word. In the New Testament, grace means God's love in action toward people who merited the opposite of love. Grace means God moving heaven and earth to save sinners who could not lift a finger to save themselves. Grace means God sending his only son to the cross to descend into hell, Hades, so that we guilty ones might be reconciled to God and received into heaven. That was J.I. Packer from his book, Knowing God. All of that being true, all of that being important in our lives. Conforming to God's holiness. The God of the Old Testament is the same God as the God of the New Testament. And the Old Testament was given to us to show how far we are from God. Those laws that the Jews asked for showed that we can't live up to any part of that. Small little pieces. And when we do something right, we're so excited, we're so wonderful, we're so... No, we're not. And the New Testament came so that we could see Jesus Christ and his life and his new teaching. And the New Testament continuously looks back to the cross. You think of how many people were told about Jesus Christ and what he did for us, and how many have ignored that? Well, for some of us, we haven't ignored it. We know who Jesus Christ is and what he did. And when we look back to the cross, we know that's our salvation. I'm going to give you an Old Testament verse, then a New Testament verse. Old Testament, Deuteronomy 4, verse 24. Mama. For the Lord your God is a consuming fire, a jealous God. John in the New Testament, 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whomsoever believeth upon him shall have eternal life. Easy. Easy. Just believe on Jesus Christ, you'll have eternal life. Now keep in mind, those that don't are going to have eternal life also, but in a whole different place. Number three, the Old Testament, Deuteronomy 4:31. For the Lord your God is a merciful God. He will not abandon or destroy you or forget the covenant with your forefathers, which he confirmed to them by oath. New Testament, 1 John 4, verses 7 and 8. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. That's a powerful set of words. God is love. And although we've covered it, it's absolutely true. So if you don't have love for somebody, go straighten that problem out. Work things out with them. Because there's no room for that in your life if you're a Christian, if you follow Christ. If you have God in you, then you have love in you. There's no room for any discontent. Number five, the Old Testament, Psalm 116, verse 5. The Lord is a gracious and righteous. Our God is full of compassion. Notice these things about our God. And we always think that the Old Testament God was terrible, horrible. This is the Old Testament. Again, 1 John 4, 9 through 11. This is how God showed his love amongst us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. We've been watching a show that you can pick up either on DVD or on the computer. And it's about the chosen. The chosen. We think of the Jews of the Old Testament as the chosen people. They are. That's what they're called. We're chosen also. And during the course of the show, the one thing that's constantly there is that Christ did the choosing. None of his apostles ever chose Christ. They never turned to Christ. Christ turned to them. So on top of everything, the fact that Christ chose you, when each one of us here, and some of you are much nicer people than my past history, I guarantee you, you don't want to tell me your worst sin. Stand up and announce it. Let the whole church hear it. No, we want these things buried. Yet he still chose you. With that kind of a person, none of us can say we're good. Come on, be serious. You know what you've got hidden in your past. You know the things you thought and said and felt about other people. Isn't it amazing? While we were still that way, he chose us. What a blessing Jesus Christ is. Old Testament, Exodus 34, verses 5 through 7. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and stood there with him, that's Moses, and proclaimed his name, the Lord. And he passed in front of Moses, proclaiming, the Lord, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands, and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. This bad Old Testament God, this mean God, sure did a lot of nice things. Moses was well aware of it. Romans, New Testament, Romans 6, verse 23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. We all know we sin, and we can have eternal life in the right place through Jesus Christ. God is love. We will never be able to understand God's love for us. One of the most powerful verses of Scripture is John 3:16, which I already said, but I'll say it again because you need to hear it again. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. How tough is that? How many things do you believe in that are silly and stupid and nonsensical? But that's part of life. That's what we do. We believe things. That idiot box talks, and you believe everything coming off of that just about, don't you? Until you go and find out that that's not true. But I heard it on TV. It must be. And you argue with yourself. You know, that idiot box, it tells you so many things. Take notice to what it's telling you lately. What it told you in the last year. So many things that weren't true. We're now understanding the idiot box only repeats what it's told to repeat. Now for this new year, let us take on a new approach. 1 Corinthians 13, the way of love. If I speak with human eloquence and angelic ecstasy, but don't love, I'm nothing but the creaking of a rusty gate. If I speak God's word with power, revealing all his mysteries and making everything plain as day, and if I have faith that says to the mountain, jump, and it jumps, but I don't have love, I'm nothing. Wow, that's doing all the right things, isn't it? All that faith, all that believing, all that everything, but you don't have love, it's useless. If I give everything I own to the poor and even go to stake to be burned as a martyr, but I don't love, I've gotten nowhere. See, God is saying, I am love. The Bible tells us, God is love. Well, for you to have love in you or Christ in you, you have to have love. And if you don't, then you don't have Christ in you. Love forgives. Christ teaches us to forgive our enemies. He doesn't teach us that so that we have done something so wonderful to our enemies. He teaches us that so we live better. When you forgive, you don't carry the weight of that anymore. You can actually walk away from it and at some point forget it. Not even remember what the discussion was, argument was, why we had something bad between us. It disappears. We don't think about it. But those that carry that, it never leaves them. Every time it crosses their mind, they pay a price. If I give everything I own to the poor and take stake and beg as a martyr, I've gotten nowhere. So now, the matter, what I say, what I believe, and what I do, I'm bankrupt without love. Love never gives up. Love cares more for others than for self. Think if you have all of these qualities. Love doesn't want what it does not have. Love doesn't strut proudly, doesn't have a swelled head, doesn't force itself on others, isn't always me first, doesn't fly off the handle, doesn't keep score of the sins of others, doesn't revel when others grovel, doesn't take pleasure in the flowering of truth, puts up with anything, trusts God always, always looks for the best, never looks back, but keeps going to the end. That's love. God is love. God is all of those things. We are, and I've said this before, and I know you probably don't want to hear it again, but we are disgusting. The way we treat each other is disgusting. Look at the world. It's not us here in this church. It's the whole world, humankind. We're foul. We pleasure ourselves on garbage. And we find no time to put God in the picture. And he's the one that's saying, just believe in my son. You have eternal life. Can't get no better. No, there's nothing you can do. I'll do it all. I reach out and choose you. I'm the one that does it. My son died for you. He's the one that did it. Look how many. Remember where it says the path is narrow and small? We go through that path single file, one at a time. One at a time. But the highway to destruction is wide, it's huge. Parties go through at the same time. Do you think if we all believed the way Christ says love is, that the world would be in the mess that it's in? No. All I thought about, because I like to be uplifted, and this is not uplifting, so to speak, but to how tough it's been this week, gray and dreary and raining. And then I thought about Colorado. And I thought how nice this weather is. I sat down and spoke with Louise. It was in my bedroom in two easy chairs. I said, you know, this can really get you down this many days in a row. I said, but I was thinking about Colorado, those people. They're not sitting down in their easy chair, in their bedroom, in their house, in their neighborhood. It's gone. It's been leveled to ash. Many of those people were people like you and I, people that love Jesus Christ, good people. Why did he do it to them? He didn't abandon them. He's with them. Love never dies. Inspired speech will be over someday. Praying in tongues will end. Understanding will reach its limit. We know only portions of the truth, and what we say about God is always incomplete. But when the completeness arrives, our incompleteness will be canceled. When I was an infant at my mother's breast, I gurgled and cooed like any infant. When I grew up, I left those infant ways for good. Verse 12, we don't yet see these things clearly. We're squinting in a fog, peering through a mist. But it won't be long before the weather clears and the sun shines bright. We'll see it all then. See it all as clearly as God sees us, knowing him directly, just as he knows us. But for right now, until that completeness comes, we have three things to do to lead us towards God, that consummation. Trust steadily in God, hope unswervingly, love extravagantly, and the best of all of these is love. And in John 4, 7 through 21, God is love. My beloved friends, let us continue to love each other since love comes from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and experiences a relationship with God. Everyone who loves is born of God and experiences a relationship with God. Wow. Who would you rather have a relationship with than God? The person who refuses to love doesn't know the first thing about God, because God is love. So you can't know him if you don't know love. This is how God showed his love for us. God sent his only begotten Son into the world so that we might live through him. This is the kind of love we are talking about. Not that we once upon a time loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice to clear the way of our sins and the damage that they've done to our relationship with God. That's the whole key right there. We can't have a relationship with God. He doesn't have a relationship with sinners. He loves sinners. That's why he's figured out how he can have a relationship with the sinner. But the sinner cannot reject him, cannot walk away from him, must love the way he loves. And we can do it. We really can do it. It's not impossible. We'll never love at the level of God, not here on earth. But we can love like him. We can try to overlook the things that we need to overlook. And it's not for the other guy's purpose. God is telling us these things for our own good. If I feel something poorly against one of you, and every time I see you from here, that's what crosses my mind. Who's being punished? Not you. You don't even know that I carry this load. But me. How many of us need to get on the phone and call a brother or a sister, a mother, a father, a friend, that we're having a problem with, that we haven't ironed out everything? When you do that, you're doing what God wants you to do. God is love. There's no room in God for those kind of feelings. My dear, dear friends, if God loved us like this, we certainly ought to love each other. No one has seen God ever, but if we, one another, God dwells deeply within us, and his love becomes complete in us, perfect love. This is how we know that we're living steadily and deeply in him, and he in us. He's given us life from his life, from his very own spirit. Also, we've seen ourselves and continue to state openly that our Father sent his Son, our Savior of the world. Everyone who confesses that Jesus is God's Son participates continuously in an intimate relationship with God. We know it so well, we've embraced it in our hearts and in our souls. This is love that comes from God. See, we can't find it on our own. We can't complete it on our own. We need to turn to God and ask him to show us this love, teach us this love. As this year comes upon us, change your attitude. Have the attitude that the New Testament teaches. The love for one another. Don't fear everything. Trust in God. If something is to happen to you and you are one of his children, it is going to happen to you. He lives through us this way. We don't have to run in fear from everything. I'm not saying be foolish. Wait for the train to come and jump in front of it and see if it'll bounce off your chest. No. But don't fear the train. Stand there, watch it go by. It's a marvelous thing. Trust that the train is not going to jump the tracks and hit me so I can't do that. That'd be dangerous. I can't go out the door of my house. It'd be dangerous. I can't do all the things that we don't do anymore. It'd be dangerous. No, trust in God. You know for a fact that you're going to die someday. Not today, not tomorrow, but someday. We all do. Should we spend our life worrying that that day might be today? Somehow it might be today. Then I can't live life. You know, God smiled. God laughed. That's why he put a sense of humor in us. We need to appreciate what God did to us. Not live on the hard side and punish ourselves, but free to believe that he's with us. He watches our every step. And yeah, you're going to die one day. So what? You know where you're going. It's going to be great. So for now, while you're here, live life. Don't live in fear. Trust in God. He is the reason that we are separate. We're chosen. We're special. He didn't choose everybody. And he's not going to choose everybody. That's why that roadway is a superhighway to destruction. But get that personal relationship with Jesus Christ. This is the year to change the way you live life and appreciate more what God's given you. Let's close in prayer. Holy Father, we praise you. We thank you. We know we've seen so many things really tough this past year go by, yet you carried us through it. We're all here. We're fine because of you. We know where our future lies, in heaven with you. I can't wait for that time when I'll see you in your glory, in the magnificence, and everyone that's there that lived here at one time or another on this planet will be there, the ones you've chosen, because they love the way you love. Only caring for each other, only worshiping and praising you. It's going to be wonderful, I know that, Lord. But before that happens, we have another year in front of us, and it could be another tough year. Give us the strength to take notice to what happens and turn our heads from it, and instead spend that time turned towards you. Let us not look at how rough things are, but how blessed we are, because we are truly blessed because of what you've done for us. And we ask these things through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Problems and other people's problems that we're aware of. So I turn the microphone over to you.
Your prayer of healing for Elizabeth Luciano, who's still in a ventilator.
Prayers for our friend Sue Coletti, who's recovering from a stroke, and for Donna Barnett, who's facing her first year without her husband.
Prayers for the family of Sam Corliss, who's not in very good shape, his wife Jennifer, my friend Ray Coletti, and also my friends Wayne and Michelle Reynolds, and Jackie and Kevin Kopp. Both gentlemen are doing better, by the way, since we began praying for them. Not great, but doing better.
In God's time.
Anita's sister died last week. So please pray for her.
Prayers for improved health for my parents and Kristen's parents in the new year.
And I'll add my wife to that. She is doing better. She didn't want to come today and spread germs to you guys. She said, yeah, I'll be there next week and no one else will be. So. But she is doing better. It's been a really rough cold. She actually said, I don't want to have any more weeks off because every time I get a week off, I'm homesick. The last day of school kills me. Anyone else? Yes.
My stepmom's sister's in the hospital. She has stage 4 cancer, so I'm just hoping she gets better.
Amen. Yes, Chris?
Prayers for 2 people. One of them, her name's Tara. This has been a rough 3 months for her. She got to a severe car accident in, I want to say, October-ish, and she messed up her leg pretty bad. She recovered from that, and then she got sick. So she's been sick for since early part of December, I think. So she's been pretty beat up, so prayers for healing for her. And another friend of mine, his name's Jesse, his family has COVID, and he is still recovering from it. It's been a while, so prayers for him also. And obviously,
with what happened in Colorado, I'm adding that in because it was horrible. Yet the blessing to that is very few injuries. People have stories of getting out of their house before it was totally consumed while they were on the end of their walkway leaving. We just got over Kentucky. We're not over it. We just saw Kentucky go through what it went through. Things are changing. Things aren't what they used to be. I know, and I hear, every so often hear someone say, well, it's because they cover it better in the news. No, they don't. Come on, they covered the news very well 10 years ago, 15 years ago. There's that much activity. There's that many things happening. We see weather patterns that are changing that we can't believe in. In the meantime, I see the state of New Jersey being blessed. It's not the easiest state to live in with taxes and so forth the way it is, but boy, we've had the mildest weather, even if it's a rainy day out there. It's been really mild compared to so much of the country. So let's continue to pray for the people that do all the work to maintain this state, maintain our safety throughout the country, our police, our military. They're being used like never before now because there's not enough people to cover all the jobs. So the military is coming in to cover jobs they weren't really expected to. Let's keep them in prayer. Anyone else? Okay, let's pray that Jan's back here shortly. So things run smoothly again. That's terrible to say. Things are running wonderfully, believe me. Let's close in prayer. Holy Father, we need your help like never before. We need you continuously. And for some of us who already know you as our Lord and Savior, we know that we can rely on you and trust in you. Our only problem is that we have a tendency to worry about problems. Instead of spending the time praising you and thanking you, we worry. And you don't want us to do that, and we know that. So teach us this year, Lord, to rely on you, to entrust you with everything we have, because that's what you want of us. But you want all of us, not just part. And if someone needs to worry, I'd rather it be you than me, because you're much more capable. You're in control, and we thank you for that. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
3 verses 1 and 2, the Psalm of David. Bless and affectionately praise the Lord, O my soul, and that all that is deep within me, bless his holy name. Bless and affectionately praise the Lord, O my soul, and do not fret any of his benefits. This, as always, especially now, this beginning the first of the year, is our time to share the Lord's table together. So take a moment to think about anything you may want to discuss with God before you partake of this. So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. But if you were more discerning with regard to ourselves, we would not come under such judgment. Nevertheless, when we are judged in this way by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be finally condemned with the world. So then, my brothers and sisters, when you gather to eat, and you should all eat together, anyone who is hungry should eat something at home, so that when they meet together, it is not a result of judgment. And when I come, I will give further directions. At this time, we share the bread of Christ. And as we come together for this meal, we share this cup, a cup of the new and everlasting covenant that will be shed for many unto the forgiveness of our sins. Once more, Carol. Thank you. together in the Apostles' Creed. I believe
in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from dead. He descended into heaven, and sits on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. And the Lord shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Chris?
Because you were forsaken, I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven. Because you were forsaken, I am accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me. Because you died.
And now, before we eat, because once we get near that food, there's craziness happening. Let's say grace. Holy Father, we ask you to bless this food and this time we have together. May this be first of many meals that we share together this year. May you continue to bless this church as you have. May it grow to bring more praise, honor, and glory to you. And we ask this, Lord, through your Son's holy and precious name, Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
And those who aren't coming over, go and have a marvelous week. God bless. Thank you.